coming out tonight for this Women in Biohealth event. Welcome to Exact Sciences and our new headquarters building. I'm Margaret Albuquerque. For those of you who do not already subscribe to the Women in Biohealth newsletter, you may not have seen our Save the Date notification. We have another event coming up in July 21st. At the Eastside Club, which is a great location right on Lake Monona, outdoor space. We're gonna have a networking event there, so put it on your calendar. If it rains, we're gonna have the event the following Thursday, the 28th. So thanks for coming. I'll hand it over to Larry.
Sure. I'm especially thankful for Margaret and Exact Sciences for hosting us. It's great to be in this lovely space at one of the main businesses in the biohealth industry in our area. And I'd also like to thank our panelists and introduce you to them. I'll do a brief intro, but I'll have them each introduce themselves. So starting nearest to me, Mary Engler, Associate Director of Project Management from Catalent. Leslie, who is in Product Development at Illumina. And Betsy, who joined us the last minute, thankfully, to fill in, and we're very excited to have her from Product Development at Exact Sciences. So welcome to our panelists. Before we move into intros, I'll have Risa switch screens to our Slido event. So this is meant to be an interactive panel, and to make it easier for you guys to ask questions, we do have a Slido event code. So all you have to do is either enter the event 3470862 on your phone or scan the QR code, and you'll be able to ask and upvote your own questions, and I'll articulate them. So feel free to add them, and we can make this dynamic. But we're here today to talk about careers and share real life experiences of women working in our own industry. And we have some senior leaders of organizations in our area here to talk about their own unique career paths. All right. So with that, I guess I'll have everyone introduce themselves. I can start first. So as I mentioned, I'm Lauren Henderson. I'm currently working at Arrowhead as a senior project manager in CMC, so overseeing manufacturing both internally and externally, but my background is in project management and microbiology with experience in QC testing. Mary?
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Mary Lark. I'm an Associate Director of Program Management at Catalent. I've been with Catalent for about 2 years. Prior to that, I have roughly 16 years of experience at MilliporeSigma, where I like to say I followed the product. I started in process development, transitioned into tech transfer role, and then into manufacturing leadership, and finally into quality, before I made the decision to move away from small molecules into biologics and into program management.
Hello everyone, I'm Leslie. I am currently a program manager at Illumina in the new product development team. Prior to that, really my industry experience starts at Roche, where I started research and development, and then sort of similar to Mary, took a winding route through the company, which I've often referred to as the grand tour. Going from R&D to operations, to bioinformatics, eventually to tech support, all of those together in the program manager role.
Nice to meet both of you, all of you. Nice to meet this group. My name is Betsy Kleba. I am in product management, where I'm a director here at Exact Sciences. Like my fellow panelists, I've had a journey here within Exact Sciences, having worked in a few different functions, starting with IT. I am a molecular biologist by training with a background in infectious diseases and immunology, and came to Exact Sciences through an acquisition of a software company, which is how I ended up in IT, and found myself pondering, how did I get here? I was really excited about Exact Sciences and the mission, and it would be a great learning opportunity, and it has been absolutely that. I did a stint in the clinical laboratory before joining the product development, product management team, which is where I am today. So thrilled to be here.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys. Appreciate the introductions. So you guys have a little background, and I can see you guys interacting with the screen, so appreciate it. I'll try to keep up with you here on my phone. That's what I'm doing. I'm not texting. But here to have real conversations, right? And it looks like you guys are interested in the background, and I think that your in- intros are a great start to a first question that I'd like to ask each of you, but I'll start with Betsy. You mentioned at one point you were thinking, how did I get here? So that makes me wonder, what was the original plan, and is this exactly how it was meant to go?
No. No, but it's been a wonderful non-planned event, and I will start off by saying I've absolutely let my career be guided by, I call them my two core principles. Whatever I do, I want to be making a positive impact, and I need to be learning and growing. And so you could do that in lots of different ways. And I found myself here through a circuitous set of events. I actually had been in academia for a number of years and wanted to make and did make a jump out of academics into industry by joining a small startup company. And within a year, we were acquired by Exact Sciences. And so when you ask, was it on my path to be here? Absolutely not. I was drawn to the small startup because as a startup, member of a startup, you get to wear many hats, you will learn a lot. I was going to engage with a customer, I was going to engage with engineers. I was building the quality system, and I love that. I love the variety of that role. And so with the acquisition within a year, being rolled into IT, and I'm like, I don't know IT. I'm a molecular biologist. But what I did quickly discover and realize was that within a more complex organization, IT touches everything. And I knew I could learn the business that Exact Sciences was engaged in by being a part of IT. I knew it would be hard, and it was humbling. But I did learn a lot that, interestingly enough, has helped me be successful in the role I am today because I understand that the technical side of IT systems that run entire businesses in addition to the laboratory. So not intending to do that, but have found it to be incredibly beneficial in what I do today.
And so you said a lot of this was driven by curiosity, learning, acquisition chance, and I see Mary nodding constantly. So I'm gonna ask Mary the same question, really. Was this the plan, and how did you get here?
No, this definitely was not the plan. My background, as I mentioned, was small molecules, and I have my doctorate in natural product synthesis, so organic chemist by training. A lot of biologists thrown at organic chemistry, but I kind of agree. And when I was looking at career path and whatnot, deciding what to major in as an undergraduate, and then later on going into graduate school, a lot of my path was guided by the continuous learning opportunity, and then also a little bit by family. I'm originally from the Midwest, so I did my undergraduate here at UW, and then I made the decision to go to graduate school at the University of Minnesota because it was closer to my family, and based off of where the large pharmaceutical companies were at the time, I thought I would end up on the East or West Coast. And I had an opportunity to join a very small startup. I was one of the last people to interview like everybody in the building before being able to be offered the job. And I started in process development, and it was that continuous learning plus an opportunity to work with multiple clients, work on various applications, and understand that the products I was working on were impacting clients. And then as I was involved and engaged in these various projects, I saw, okay, this is process development's wheel. I understood that, and now I want to understand manufacturing's wheel. So I was given an opportunity because I was wearing many hats to actually be in production and then be part of that and then continually build upon those pieces, which to me is an important part of your career path because you always want to know what you're doing has purpose and you want to understand the why. Not everybody wants to do that, but I highly encourage you to do that because it opens so many different doors for you. And it also allows you to be an advocate and to be able to explain to others why you're doing what you're doing. So even though some of us may have a path, my path was not clearly defined. I'm still trying to figure out what I want to do when I grow up. But at the same time, keep learning, keep striving for those opportunities, as well as challenge yourself.
All right, there's a lot of people engaged in this topic, and I think I'll let Leslie answer that too, to give us a little more background. But again, Leslie, was this your plan?
No. If you told me, you know, 15 years ago I'd be doing what I'd be doing now, I would have thought you were crazy. And really, you know, to me, a lot of this was, you know, I went to school, I probably really from a young age knew I was interested in science and that was what I wanted to do. And I went through, you know, undergrad and started working in a lab. I was like, I love this. And I went to grad school and I was like, I still love this. And, you know, eventually when I ended up at Roche, I was in R&D, I was in the lab. I was like, I love this. For me, what really jolted me off of that, though, was we restructured and suddenly I found myself in a different position in not in R&D and suddenly wondering, now what do I do? You know, this wasn't the plan. This was never ever any part of the plan. And kind of that time, though, gave me time to reflect and think, well, what really is it? In longer term, what is it? Do I really see myself in the lab 20 years from now? And really know, like, especially now if I go back in the lab, I'm not good at it anymore. There are things that, you know, as I get older, my eyes aren't as good. I can't see little tubes. It's hard. And really, then I just started kind of coming back to what, you know, both of the other panelists have said. I got curious if what else was out there. And instead of, you know, my knee-jerk reaction of I need to get back into R&D, that's when I started looking at bioinformatics and thinking, well, if I do go back into R&D, I'll be better if I can, you know, do some coding and look at my own analysis. But it also was a customer-facing position. And I was like, well, another option is that I then go into training or support. And that's where it ended up taking me, and I really love that. Got curious and grew there, and then it was kind of the next thing was, you know, again, site shutdown. So it's now what do I do? And that's when I started looking at, well, I had this experience from all these different parts of the organization. Where can I capitalize on all that knowledge and really start to bring things together and essentially what's next? And that's how I then started into program management. So it was kind of, you know, I had a plan, I was knocked off it. And that jolt then really taught me that what I wanted was something that I'm always growing, I'm always learning, I'm always finding out new things. I get bored really easily. So, you know, there's definitely an aspect to moving around and learning new things all the time that drives that path.
So as we were going through that journey, Leslie, I'll just ask this question to you. What advice did you get, and what advice would you have given yourself as you were navigating all of these different moves, especially making big changes, like you said, from going to lab, to IT, to being customer-facing? What advice would you give yourself about planning your career?
I think it's really, make sure you're really deeply checking in with yourself and what really excites you and what those core values are. So, you know, kind of, you, like I said, I definitely had some knee-jerk reactions in some of those moments, and those were not really the things that would have driven me to where I am or where I really in the end wanted to be. There was a lot of self-reflection, there was a lot of patience. I am not a patient person. So, you know, it took that kind of adjustment, and so it's really know yourself, really check in with yourself even when you're not in a big moment of, did I like today? Was today a good day? And what about that made it great? Did I think today was really bad? And if so, why? What did I not like and I don't want to do anymore? And just follow those things and try to do more of what you like and, you know, do it in little bits. And as you find out more, get into it more. You know, that's really what I would say is just, you know, take stock and what's fun, what's not, and follow.
All sound advice. And isn't it always easier going back in the past and telling yourself?
By far. By far. Very hard to tell myself that.
So speaking of advice we got, right? If we were to give ourselves advice, that's one thing looking back. The rest of us can learn from your experiences. But Mary, you've mentioned to me in past conversations that you've had a lot of connections that have supported your career. Did you have any mentors throughout your journey that coached you along the way?
So they were, yes, and the short answer is yes. However, it's more complicated than that. My mentors weren't assigned. They weren't formal mentors. They were people that I built relationships with within the organization, not necessarily purposeful. Some of them were definitely accidental. But they were people that I could trust and utilize for sounding boards. out there. Formal mentorships are wonderful. However, there is an opportunity to leverage the knowledge and support of your colleagues and build that relationship. I still have some of my former colleagues and we get together on roughly an annual basis and we go through and all of us are in different areas now, but we talk about what the issues are that we're facing. And when you can start having those conversations with people, what you'll realize is it doesn't matter if you're working here or if you're working across the street or if you're working at Catalent, a lot of the issues and the opportunities that are out there are common between each and every organization that we have.
Lovely advice. You can do it over beers instead of a formal agenda-driven meeting, right?
This is very true.
And Betsy, I saw you nodding as well. Are there some connections that have influenced or supported your career within your organization or outside of it?
I think I would echo what Mary is saying in that the most influential relationships are ones that are happenstance, ones that I've developed through friendships, through just work and getting to know people, or through things like this, where you connect with people and suddenly you realize you have some commonality or are facing similar issues. I think that it's great when organizations have formal mentoring programs because I think that's another way to develop relationships. But Mary, what you said hit home for me because it's really more about the serendipitous relationships that you don't know are going to benefit you because you don't know what challenges lay in front of you that you leverage when all of a sudden you find yourself stumbling or struggling with something and you're like, oh, I've heard about this, or I'm going to ask this person because they might be in the same situation. So I think that's where it becomes important if you find yourself in a, if we're all scientists who like to sit at a bench quietly and think, it can be hard to open ourselves up to relationships and develop those friendships even informally, and that's something I've had to do very consciously to make sure that I'm growing those connections because those connections are not just beneficial to me, they're beneficial to those around me, and rising seas raise all boats, and so I think that's the motto we should all employ.
Agreed. I think it's great that you were able to leverage connections and your curiosity and skills. Leslie, you mentioned you were looking at all different areas of the organization to learn new skills and move into roles, but did you take on any specific projects or leverage your connections to get those projects so that you could move into a new area that was maybe outside your comfort zone?
Yes. I'm trying to think specific ways. I mean, I guess it happened, you know, some things were like a training I just would offer to help out when there was training in town and just, you know, see what it was like. Bioinformatics, it was just kind of the site offered intro course and then you could kind of play with it. And then I just would obviously try to apply it and then I would go ask questions of the team when I get stuck. But then otherwise there were other things, like there a big move towards, you know, management and team management was, you know, we had other teams that weren't really related at all to, you know, your position. So different site teams, you know, we had things like environmental teams or employee engagement teams, and really getting involved in the employee engagement one was one where I got my first real taste of some of this team leadership role. So there are always all kinds of different little things outside of that that you can usually find, and it's a lot of times it's just asking, right? You know, people are there and they're usually willing to help. They're usually really excited to talk to you about what they do, but you just have to make that effort to go ask.
Yeah. So your overachieving wasn't just an extra work-related projects; you had extracurricular activities too. Yeah.
Yes.
And Betsy, I saw you were nodding as well, and in your intro you mentioned you were taking on new roles with an acquisition that you were like, what am I doing? Were there any specific projects that helped you move to your current role or any of your previous roles?
Yes, and I think going back to the theme of, you know, the informal networking creating opportunities that you maybe weren't expecting, I landed in my current role through that sort of a situation. I've been working in the clinical laboratory, and part of my role in that space was preparing to bring on a new test. that work and partnering with other functions across the organization and asking questions. And by the way, the new test we were bringing on, it was the next test after Cologuard, so it was brand new for the organization, a lot of change that went along with that, and asking questions, trying to connect dots in an organization that was learning how to launch products that allowed me to grow the connections that ultimately pulled me into the role that I am today. So it wasn't seeing it, trying to make it happen. It wasn't leveraging mentorships, but it was leveraging relationships and through those relationships and being open to an opportunity that arose and being willing to take it that really allowed me to get there. So asking questions and being curious about things and trying to connect dots and see where you can add value. Be curious. And being curious, it's amazing who you connect with and what you learn and opportunities that arise just from that.
So that's really helpful. And our audience is thinking a little bit more granular and they want to look back at some of your guys' experience and say, right now we're talking about ways you guys have made moves, but what are times you felt the need to? So a question that's kind of blowing up on the screen is, have you ever felt stuck in your career? And what are some tips for resolving that or deciding to transition to a new role? So maybe Mary, I'll have you take that first, and this is the new one, so I'll say it again. It's essentially, have you ever been stuck, and how do you get unstuck?
So throughout my career, I've been provided opportunities or earned opportunities to take on various projects and programs in various states. And there was one project in particular which had a 2-year Gantt chart when I started. And by the time we were done with everything, it had ballooned into about a 5-year program. And my role within the program had changed a little bit. However, I was always looking for that program to be done. It's one of those where I built a great relationship with the client, we were beginning to deliver, it was getting great clinical results, but I was ready to move on to something else. But because I was so intertwined in this program, and I could tell you all the RMS numbers, I could tell you what step that related to, what advocacy needed to look like, who I needed to talk to, for all of the above. But at that point in time, it was time for the program to be done and for me to move on and let other people take over the program and learn those specification numbers and the IPCs I'm going to talk to. And it was also time for me to look at working with other programs. And at that time, looking back, I didn't view it as being stuck because I still enjoyed working with the client things, but I looked at, okay, I'm good, this is in a good spot, I'm ready to hand this torch off and find my new spot and find what I want to. And at the same time, another program had come up. I had let my manager at the time know I'm ready to take on new programs. And by my involvement in that program and the demonstration of my behaviors as well as my willingness and yearning to learn all of the different aspects of it, I had shown that I was capable of taking on something bigger, but also that I was capable of having people report into me or being able to take for the company to take a risk and say, okay, now can we move you up a level? And for those that are stuck, my advice to you is, one, be confident in you and who you are and what you want to do. You are your own advocate at any point throughout your career. If you're unhappy because of the people you're working with, don't complain about the people you're working with. Seek to find a new work family. If you're unhappy with what you're working on for a program, finish it up, let your boss know or your manager know, and then seek to find a new program. And if all of the above does not work for you, seek to find a new opportunity and challenge yourself. But again, it's that confidence in you that you have to start with.
That kind of tackles the next question that actually popped up on the screen.
So I cannot see the screen there.
I know. So fun for me. I'll challenge Leslie to take it too, though. You know, have you ever been stuck? How did you get unstuck? Or how did you recognize even? So this next question that came in is like, how do you know it's the right time to pursue a new opportunity? So that could be a role, a different position. Like you said, you moved from the lab into bioinformatics, product management. How do you know it was time to make a big change?
I think it's just when there's something out there that's what the next step is. I don't know that it's so much like this feeling of I need out as much as, you know, to be better at what I do or to maybe do something different or bigger. I need this other skill set. I need this other set of experience and finding that opportunity. You know, so really for me, like the bioinformatics move was, it was there. The position opened up at a time where, you know, I was looking at, do I want to go back to R&D? And if I did, what did I need to do to go back better than I was, right? To not just go back to where I was, but to go back in kind of some sort of bigger capacity. And to me, that was, I was, had a lot of bench experience. I'm a biochemist by training, but I was really clumsy with coding and trying to look at my data. And so I was like, if I want to be better when I go back, I needed to be better at that. And so it was then that opportunity is there. And again, and, you know, it was there because I was asking questions beforehand anyways, right? So it's kind of, this position opens up and I apply for it, and, you know, if anybody says, well, why is Leslie looking at that? Somebody would say, oh no, I know, she came, she's asking me questions, she's trying to do all this stuff, and I can see why that makes sense. You know, so it really is just kind of, a lot of it's being ready for the opportunity when it comes. You never know when it's gonna come. And you know, just make sure that you kind of ask questions and done your homework beforehand, and when it comes, take it. Because it might not be there in 6 months or a year or 2 years. You know, it's just really seize the moment.
Thanks. So being interested, looking for it, seeking things out, that's how you made the moves and that's how you knew you were ready. But Betsy, how about we take the next question for you? The team would like to know more. The team, we're a team now, guys. The group, you know, project manager. The collective group would like to know, I guess, when is the right time to seek a promotion? How do you know that you're ready for one, and how do you ask for it?
Well, that's a great question. I think it depends. Every organization is different. And the kind of organization you're in will dictate the climate and the culture in which you are seeking that promotion. I think the first thing that you need to do is to just survey the context and what is the climate in, of your organization. Look at your peers and the people who are now at the level where you aspire to be, and see if you can glean some insights into what it was that they had accomplished that allowed them to make that next step. Ideally, you're going to have open dialogue with your manager along the way. I think the key is, again, in the ideal scenario, it's not a surprise. It shouldn't be a surprise for you. I don't think it should be a surprise for your manager. The ideal scenario is you're talking, you understand what the benchmark is, what it is that they're looking for in terms of accomplishments, behaviors, whatever it is, again, in your organization that would let you get to that next level, and so that you're working toward it and you're getting the feedback for continuous growth. I keep saying ideally because if you're like me, you're like, how often do we find ourselves in an ideal situation, and is that always happening? And it's not always. So I think if you're finding yourself in a position where you believe you're ready for a promotion, or if you're even questioning, again, go back and do a survey to see what it is you think that group in the level that you aspire to be, what were their accomplishments? How would you wrap up and package and talk about your accomplishments to make the case that you are indeed ready for that next level? And I think that's really the starting point then for that conversation with your manager, if you haven't been having it all along, is start making that case. I would say come to that conversation with an open mind, and with openness to whatever your manager is going to say back to you. I think neither they nor you want to be painted in a corner or feel like this is a surprise or there's any confrontations. So I would say use it as an opportunity to open up a dialogue that may take time to ultimately resolve at an outcome that you both feel good about. But if you go, you into it with that spirit, I think you're going to walk away from it feeling really good, whether they're saying, yeah, we agree, you're ready for the promotion now, or no, but you're so close, and here are the two things that we'd like to see you accomplish or get under your belt before we go to that next step.
I love that advice, to kind of take stock in your accomplishments and your peers, to seek it out, have open dialogue, and it really builds on what Leslie said about making connections and having conversations so it's not a surprise. I think you both said that people should know what you're interested in. It shouldn't catch anyone off guard. But ultimately, it is a risk, right, asking for that. And the audience, I was going to say the team again, almost got me. The audience wants to know, what's the biggest risks you've taken in your career? So I guess maybe I'll let one of you volunteer to share. Does anyone want to share the biggest risk or a big risk you've taken in your career? I can call on someone too.
I'm holding the shell, so I'll just start. When I was in academia, I had just landed an NSF grant. I was granted a sabbatical, and I was going to go off and do my research. But the 3 years leading up to that point, we were talking about being restless when you know it's time for a change, and I was very restless, was starting to feel stuck. Someone asked that about being stuck. And so I've been doing a lot of internal reflection. What do I want? Am I still getting my needs met professionally from the position that I'm in? Does this still feel right? Am I still getting where I want to go? All the things that you both are saying, it's like we're kindred spirits. Anyway, short story is, the leap of faith that I took, or the risk I took, was at a point where I should have been saying I finally arrived and I'm finally really taking off because I'm getting the funding for my laboratory and making a name for myself professionally as a scientist. Was also the point I said I walked away from all of that and started something completely different and jumped into industry. And it was a risk, but I felt comfortable doing that because I'd done that internal reflection and kept asking myself, where am I trying to go? And I don't mean the job title. It was more like, what are the things I want to do? And what are the things I want to understand? What sort of career path do I want to? It was more about creating opportunities for myself. And I felt like everything I was doing was painting me into a smaller corner. The worst thing I can do for myself, for me, knowing myself, is feel trapped. And I was feeling trapped. And so it was just asking, what is something I can do to open more doors and allow me to feel like I was creating more options for myself for my future? And so that's how I ultimately decided I was willing to take that leap of faith and take what felt like a really big risk at the time. In the end, I think it turned out fabulous, but you don't know that in the moment.
That is a big risk, complete change. How about you, Mary? Would you like to share a huge risk in your career?
So, just a personal reflection. I looked at each time I transitioned in my career for different roles. Was I ready? Are people going to trust that I can fulfill this role? So, in moving from an individual contributor to a leader, there's challenges that come up with that, and there's changes that come in your relationships with people, as well as what you're expected to know. And so each of those times that you take that, I viewed it as a risk. Can I do this job? Am I capable? What am I going to do if it doesn't work out? What's my backup plan? I always joked that my backup plan was to become a vending machine stalker. Now with the cost of gas and everything, it's not a very good backup plan, but that was my backup plan. It's always been, and that's one thing that's remained steadfast throughout my career, is I have a backup plan. But each time you do take those things, there is risks involved, and there are things to consider. So with my increasing responsibility throughout my career, the other thing that I needed to look at was impact to family and my time with family and what that meant, my roles outside of work. And with it, I found ways to balance things and to move things through and be able to, say, coach my daughter's basketball team, right? And be able to be a leader at work and then be a leader outside of work and be involved in the community. But each of those is risks, right? If I choose to coach my child's basketball team, what are other people at work going to think when you have to get there at 5 o'clock for practice? But those are things that, again, it reflects back to confidence in yourself, being able to look at what you're doing do it with integrity, do the best that you can when you're at work, and then continue to have those relationships at work from a support network standpoint. Okay.
So the audience is also interested in some more color on your risk, Bessie. I saw several questions pop through specifically asking for how long do you recommend people work in lab and academia before moving to industry? And also secondary to that, do you think you had any backlash for walking away from academia for industry?
Great questions. I don't think there's a prescribed length of time. I think it's what's right for you, what's right for your situation. Your, a lot of what you said really resonated with me. Can I do this job? Am I ready for this job? Can I be successful? Is this going to get me where I want to go? I think those are the questions. And so my advice is open yourself up rather than feeling like I must check this box and do these certain things. If you can allow yourself to be more open, and I use the word opportunistic, even though that has a negative connotation, be opportunistic. One of you just said, like, there are things that happen, it might not be there 6 months from now. If that's exciting to you and your gut's telling you, wow, this could be really exciting, but you're scared, lean into that. That's the thing you should be picking up on. If you're finding yourself feeling less inspired and you're waking up in the morning not feeling like I'm ready to jump out of bed and do what I do and tackle the crazy that all of us tackle every day, why, right? Ask yourself why. Is this still giving me what I want? So I don't think that there's a prescribed amount of time. I know people who've flip-flopped back and forth between industry and academia. I think if you are a person who's only been in one or only been in the other, you will hear advice counter to that. I think you can do whatever you want to do because you're going to create the path, you're going to create the connections, and you're going to make it happen, and you're going to find the relevant skill set and the connections that allow you to be successful in whatever space you need to. Backlash, there's no backlash. I mean, I think anytime you leave a position, you know, you're breaking relationships and promises, and people are assuming you're going to show up for one job and you're saying, I'm going to take another opportunity. So there's that risk. But you manage that by building good relationships and being open to your understanding. I heard you say, you're going to complete this job, I'm not going to leave you hanging. So you know, we operate with integrity and make sure that you're fulfilling your obligations and be really transparent about what your plan is and commit to helping in a transition plan. And I think the reality is that's the best we can all do, and expecting no change is probably not realistic for anybody.
All right, so one of the other questions that's kind of risen to the top here, so I'll ask it for the audience, and I'll ask to Leslie. Do you have any favorite resources? And they included examples of books, podcasts, TED Talks that you go to for advice.
Geez, I love to read. I do listen to podcasts. So podcasts in particular, I'm a huge fan of Brené Brown. So she's got two, Dare to Lead and Unlocking Us. They're hilarious. They're also insightful. She's fabulous. And all of her books. Otherwise, books, sometimes I pick them up. I mean, I've read like a whole bunch of gamut of them, right? You know, like all the standards of whose names are escaping me at the moment. Sometimes I find out about things. So, Rethink by Adam Grant was what I just read. It was a lot of fun. They're just other ones, you know, and a lot of times I have to admit, sometimes I start them because they sound great and I get like a chapter in and I decide I don't want to read it anymore. So that happens too. But yeah, you know, also it's kind of a professional organization. So I belong to the Project Management Institute, being a program manager. There are lots of times books and recommendations that come up through various sites there. When I was in training in technical support, I was part of the Association for Talent Development. They also have lots of recommendations that come up. And like I said, it's kind of what's pertinent to me at the moment, and I am not afraid to read something for a chapter in the kitchen. So it's that helping me, I think, is
so not remembering names, but you did name Brené Brown, and I actually actually read her book because of your recommendation, and I would also share it with all of you. It's great. But I love that you mentioned more extracurriculars. I would say you're in all of these professional organizations outside of work and within your workplace, and you're working cross-functionally. I kind of wonder how you have any free time at all.
I don't know. I like to be busy. I don't like to be bored. I don't like to sit around.
Curiosity.
Yeah, and a lot of the teams and things that I'm on, I really, especially having this crazy career path and knowing that I went from this point where I thought I was going to go down this one and I've gone somewhere completely different, I feel really strongly about helping other people learn and grow too and trying to share that and help them find their path. So that's kind of what led me to the WIP group too that I help with. So, other things that are not necessarily directly science related, but definitely part of the core of who I am, get involved in them. And so definitely kind of to what Mary was saying about those connections, around town, there's, those positions and openings and opportunities exist everywhere. And it's just kind of sometimes knowing the people and the connections and finding that spot.
Well, it certainly seems there's plenty of things you guys can keep yourselves busy with, but I know you are all women, surprise, and most of you are mothers, correct? And I know, Mary, you actually mentioned in one of your responses your family commitments. I guess, how did that come into planning and navigating your career?
So, it did. I have three children. I have a 13-year-old, a 9-year-old, and a 5-year-old. And they do keep me very busy. When I first came into the industry, I was worried about timing for having a child, worried about what the perception would be. A, you just started the job you're in, and now you're going to have a baby. So I actually waited 5 years to have my first child. And looking back, what I would tell my younger self is don't do that. Flat out, don't. Look at what the benefits are so you know that you get at least 3 months with your baby. When you do decide to have a child, because that's very important. At least it was important to me. But the other part of this is for those who are planning, because some of us are planners, some of us are managers and project managers, so there's planning in there. The moment you decide to have a child is the moment your life is no longer in your control. You don't have to be pregnant. You have to decide that you want to have a child. So do keep that in mind for all of us who want to be moms out there. And then the other part is you may be scared to tell others that I'm expecting and my life is going to change because I'm having a baby. But you know what? There's fantastic people out there who are going to support you. One of the best advice I had is a friend of mine down in Texas. I had my first child, as a new mom, kind of protected the baby and everything. I grew up actually kind of wanting to share my baby because I loved holding babies, but she said to me, she was married, it takes a community to raise a child. I've gone to a number of events where people talk about leaving the baby for the first time to go on a business trip. And the takeaway from it is your child will be a stronger person because you as a mom may not have been there 100% because there's other people who can help you fill roles that you may not have realized that your child needed. And that child will maybe be more independent because you're not there. Don't get me wrong. I had a ton of mother guilt each time I left my kids. But on the flip side, it takes a community to raise a child. It takes those relationships, and it's going back to a very common theme here, is you have a network, you have a community, everybody wants to support each other. We all have commonalities. We're all looking to find and be in the sciences and be able to impact people's lives with those sciences. The same applies to your children. And the same applies to your decision as to when you want to have a child. And I cannot stress enough two things, which are it takes a community to raise a child, and the moment that you decide you want to have a child is when you're no longer in control of your life.
Appreciate you sharing that. Leslie, did this come into your planning as well, career-wise and family? Did they intersect?
Yes. So I definitely didn't necessarily, when we did decide to have our daughter, it wasn't necessarily what I would have considered the ideal time. From a career standpoint, but yes, it's very, she said there's no ideal time. And that's kind of what it came down to. It's like, it's not gonna be any better 2 years from now than it is now. And so, you know, we had our daughter. And it definitely does take a village. Definitely played in a bit. You know, I probably wouldn't have pursued like the global training and support role when she was younger. You know, when I did take that on, she was a little older, so she was more self-sufficient. You know, partly because, you know, trusting her dad to do everything, right? That's a really hard thing to do. And we don't have any family in town either. But it takes a village. Kind of an anecdotal story. My daughter graduated high school about a year ago, and we were luckily able to have, you know, an outdoor graduation party. And my uncle was there visiting from Indiana, so he has only been up here like once, right? And he commented afterwards when I saw him, he said, you know, he's like, I love how you just were walking around talking to everybody. You know, I was like, I wish I could do that. And I thought, I can't. I'm an introvert. I don't know how to work a room, right? What you saw was me with the village of people that helped me raise her, right? I could point to that room and say, that family over there, she would walk to their house with their daughter every day after school, and they would take her to dance class because they both took classes together. I would then, when I got done with work, pick them up and take them home, right? The other family over there, she was the piano teacher who lives down the street, so my daughter could walk there after school on her own, and I didn't have to get there. You know, it was like I could basically point to all these people in the room and have some story like that of other friends and families helping us out. And yeah, there's no great time, but you find those people, they're all here. Madison's a great community. Everybody here, all the people you work with, they're probably willing to help. I mean, I have people that I work with, a babysitter, you know, and sometimes even, you know, help us out in huge pinches. So there's no ideal time, but you find the support of the people who are there.
Betsy, is there anything you'd like to add to that one?
I would certainly echo everything you both said because it's true, it takes a village, it is no longer your life. And I would emphasize, where you no longer control your life, but what I wanted to emphasize is it's still your life. And so it's up to you. There is no ideal time. And if the thing I always talk about, if you're like weighing pros and cons of having kids, you will never have a pro list that outweighs the con list. It is not a logical decision, and I just want to put that out. It's just not. And yet we do it. And what I was saying on the flip side of it, having just again decided to take a leap of faith and did it twice, is, oh my gosh, there's also nothing that compares to when you are raising your child and holding your baby in your arms and watching them grow and, you know, watching them cry and causing you angst and all of those things. So I think you have to remember, it is your life, and what pieces of your life do you want to create? And if this is something you want to do, just like your career path, how are you going to make it work? And your own set of contacts, your own unique experiences, you'll find a way to make it work. And you're talking about the village, you will find your village out of sheer necessity, because you will run into a scenario and you're like, I need someone to do something. Who I know, and you're gonna ask, or someone's gonna appear. So don't let fear, I think the theme is, don't let fear stop you from pursuing a career change, pursuing a family. It's your life. What do you want to create, and how are you going to create it? Even if you said, I've got a straight and narrow path, which none of us have had, you're gonna have things that happen to you because it's life, and you have to figure out how to navigate that. So why don't you take the bull by the horns and say, I'm gonna create this chaos in my life because I want it, and I'm just gonna relish every moment because that's what it is.
I feel motivated, like I could charge off and do something, I'm not sure what, but you guys have the amped. But with that, it sounds like you guys have had a community of support, both in the workplace and at home, in the community in general. But how has the role of women in the biohealth industry changed over your career? Or what has your experience been as a woman? So maybe, Mary, would you like to start? Have you had any unique experiences that maybe your counterparts may not have had, or visions you saw as a woman and a mother in the workforce?
So the answer, short answer is yes. Had several experiences where I was the only female in a group at work. So when I came in every day, it was me and the guys. And I was very well supported throughout it. And I've also been working with clients basically my entire career. And I have been treated differently with certain clients because I was a female and I needed to prove things. I had a program where my manager at the time gave me the project and said, I don't think they've ever made this. Here you go. And I said, okay. I made it. He didn't. And that created a fun conversation where I needed to give him all of the data. I needed to show him what he made. And then I needed to show him my procedure to make it. And on the other side of the phone, one day he could have said, good work, whatnot, silence, 30 seconds, long as 30 seconds. But you know what? I was proud of the accomplishment that I had done and the team that I had supporting me had done. And this molecule is now actually going through commercial production. So it's pretty cool, yes. But again, it comes back to the confidence in yourself and being able to deliver. And then for perspective of women, I remember in graduate school, we also had a similar women's group, and women would come in and they were the trailblazers. They would talk about stories of being in business development and having to go out with a group of media guys to some seedy places. We don't have to do that anymore, which is awesome. But at the same time, I hesitate to treat myself differently because I'm a female. But what I want to do is encourage everybody who's out there, male or female, again, have confidence in who you are and pursue what you want to do. It doesn't matter what your gender is, it matters what you want to do and what you can accomplish and how you're going to go about and do it. On the flip side, I keep seeing articles out there, hey, we don't have as many women in leadership because of XYZ. Like to follow and find that role model for you and obtain it for yourself based off of that. Don't look at it as a barrier, look at it as an opportunity.
Let's see, is there something you'd like to add? Have you had any experiences, especially in academia? I've heard more of it where women have had experiences of being treated differently, and have you seen those things change in your career?
I think yes, and I think you would all support me in that. For those of you who've been in your jobs or careers for more than just a few years. The thing that popped in my head when you asked that question there, since we were just talking about having a family, I had my first child when I was a graduate student and I was working for a man who made it very clear that women in science do not have children. If you are going to be a successful scientist, you do not have children. You want to kill your career, have a kid. Full stop, no questions. And when I looked around the institution I was at, there weren't a lot of examples of the female faculty with children. So he was right, from what I could tell back then. I decided I wanted a child, I had a child, and moved on with it. But now, I would say what I hear and what I see is more women, faculty members, having babies at all times of their career because of what you said. There's no good time. Do it. The good time is when you're ready and when you feel ready and you want to do it, that's the time to do it. And I'm looking now too at here at Exact Sciences, we have an amazing parental leave program, and I'm like, oh, we should have more kids just to take advantage of that. I think these are markers. It is changing, and I said parental leave, not maternity leave, because it's regardless of your gender, if you are a parent, you need to spend time with your child. And so I think that is absolutely a sign of the time and things are changing. And those are all wonderful things. They didn't happen by accident. They happened because the community said we need to have change. And so we can't be complacent. We have to continue to drive for that equity and for the things that we need to be successful managing all of us. So yeah, it's there and it still exists, but it's better.
Great to hear you guys see it improving. Has that been your experience as well, Leslie?
I definitely see it improving. So when I had my daughter, it was 6 weeks of unpaid leave, right? And then in the those 6 weeks. I could have taken more, but it was pretty much this unspoken, unwritten expectation that, well, no, you know, so you had her on this date, you'll be back 6 weeks later. Why would you take longer? Most companies now have lots of great, you know, paid parental leave for much longer than just 6 weeks, right? And that's huge. And I think another perspective that I have is I'm married to a scientist. And so seeing him leading his lab and, you know, how he treats, you know, the people in his research group, and, you know, the difference in attitude is just so much different than what it was, you know, when we were both in grad school, right? Of this, you know, you were really expected to be in the lab all the time, right? You know, I remember spending weekends in the lab, and that's just what we did. We were there at night, you know. And that expectation has really shifted a lot, and, you know, made it so, you know, the thought of having a kid, you know, when you're working 24/7 in a lab, it seems like a horrible idea, right? But, you know, it suddenly seems like it's potentially feasible, right? Like, maybe this is a decent time, although, as we said, there's never a good time. So I kind of, through his perspective too, seen that shift, and just seen that, you know, he's watched my career and seen how it's very different from what he may have expected or even guessed 20 years ago too. And I'm not afraid to call him out when he says something that, you know, like, that was kind of out of line. You know, you shouldn't have said that, or, you know, why do you think that? So, you know, I think as more of us keep growing and taking on these positions in the workplace, and, you know, it's the people, the men that we work with, or, you know, in my case, are married to, start to see that, you know, this is really the, you know, it should be this way, it shouldn't be the way it was. So.
It's great to hear that he's an example as well too, so you have guidance from your own partner and you can give it right back too. Well, it looks like we're at the hour mark, so I want to give you guys an opportunity to give any last minute parting words before we mingle. So I guess maybe to each panelist, maybe starting with Mary, any last career advice or suggestions to the panel, because we can't get through every single question they have. Is there any other words to leave us on?
I'm just going to close in summary for myself. What my main message that I'd like to get across is you're in charge of your destiny and what you want to do, whether it be in family life or in career life. And there's great community out there to find support from. But again, you need to take the initiative to make that first step. And you need to ask yourself, am I happy where I am now? Where do I want to go, and how am I going to get there?
Yeah, I think mine is just, is really, it's that stay curious and open to opportunity. So it's going to feel scary. Really doing the same thing is, you know, if I had done that, I would definitely not be here. So it's, you know, it's going to be scary, and you're going to be afraid. But know that there are people around you to help you, and, you know, you learn and you grow, and it takes you somewhere great. So just, you know, really be open to it and take the leap.
Yeah. Maybe then the bit that I would add to that is when you are feeling scared and you're questioning yourself, questioning a decision, don't forget to look back at the accomplishments that you've already racked up in your life, the things that you're proud of, the things that have made you feel good, where you felt the most successful, and tap back into that energy in that moment and remind yourself and leverage that to let you take that leap of faith and take control of your own life. You are here today because you are doing something right and you have been successful. So when you're not feeling that way, which happens to all of us, just take a moment to pause and tap into that and remind yourself, what is it that I was doing that made me feel really good, and how do I get back there? And what changes can I make today, big or small, to help find that energy again? And you'll get there. So don't quit remembering anything. It's your life. Own it.
Well, it's great to see some real-life examples of careers that have moved intentionally, but maybe not in a perfect way. perfect ladder with a plan and not the only one who doesn't know what I want to be when I grow up to add to Mary's list. But I want to thank all of our panelists. I think you left us with some amazing advice. Also, thank you all for sharing all of your questions and coming to this event. Definitely, again, thank you to Exact, Women in BioHealth, and BioForward for making this event possible. How about a round of applause for our lovely panelists? Well, with that, I'll give you guys a break and you guys can mingle for a little bit here at Exact. We've got a little time so we can all get to know each other. And thank you again for joining us. We'll have more events from Women in BioHealth coming up. As we previously mentioned, the networking event coming up in July, the 21st on the East Side Club. But there will be more coming with Forward Fest and then the summit at the end of the year in September. So more details to follow. Hopefully you guys all signed up for the newsletter, and again, enjoy some of the snacks, and let's get to know each other. Thanks all.